And when there came a lion or a bear and took a lamb from the flock, verse 35, I went after him and struck him and delivered it out of his mouth. And if he rose against me, I caught him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has struck down both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, for he has defied the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you. Then Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David strapped his sword over his armor, and he tried in vain to go, for he was not tested them. Then David said to Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them. In other words, they don't fit, they don't approve. I don't know what's going to happen if I go out to battle with some armor that wasn't designed for me. So David put them off. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in his shepherd's pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine. Let's say amen to the reading and hearing of God's word.
Amen.
A familiar text, those of you, in case you don't know, I'll give you the name of the Philistine, so to remind you of what text I'm talking about. Goliath. This is when David goes to fight Goliath. And how many of y'all grew up, whether you grew up in church and they told you the story of Goliath, or you heard a preacher preach Goliath, or you've seen a movie or some kind of, even in sports, they say it's David versus Goliath when they're talking about a juggernaut versus a small team. Anybody ever heard that phraseology used before? Facing the Giants, or David versus Goliath match. So it's a familiar text that is used often. And I want to use this text as a basis of talking about our Mission Impossible Part 2 today. We've been dealing with this series of talking about the Mission Impossible, talking about how your journey, your destiny, how your purpose in life is impossible. It's supposed to be an impossible mission, but with God, He makes things possible. And we're looking at the life of David, not as king. Because, you know, once he's king, he's already walking in purpose. But we want to look at the life of David before he became king and his journey on the way to becoming king. Because I believe his journey speaks more to us in this room than it does. His journey speaks more to him actually being king. How many of y'all are on the journey of your purpose? You're on the path to finding out what God has for you. Amen. You're on the journey to seeing victory in your life. You're on the journey to seeing breakthroughs in your life. So I want to talk about the journey, the Mission Impossible. Amen? Yeah. And so here we have the context of David. He comes and he has heard that this Philistine Goliath is a special type of soldier. He's a giant, 9'9", 10-foot tall. And unlike the rest of the battle that is going forward, they send him out ever so often to do a different style of battling, which is one-on-one battling. And the way it's set up in that culture, that if whoever defeats one another in the one-on-one, then that settles the entire war for the winner on either side. So if Goliath wins, Goliath makes a statement in the text that if I win, you guys are going to serve us, the Philistines, you Israelites. But if your Israelites, one of your Israelite men, beat me in a one-on-one match, then we will serve you. And so the Israelites were so afraid. They were afraid because who wanted to fight a 10-foot giant? A man that from his youth was made to be a warrior. And the Israelites were short people. The average height probably was 5'7", 5'6". Of the Israelites. Saul was one of the taller ones. He was 6-something. But most Israelites were very short, so they were scared of this giant. That gives us the context of this situation. But here is David standing up and going to face this giant. And what that speaks to is so much more than just the incident or just the situation. It speaks to a character, to a man of God, that had a mission for his life, And though it looked impossible, because here is a 16-year-old kid going against a man that is trained to fight, even it looks like an impossible situation, but because God was involved, the situation was possible. Somebody say it was possible. And so what I want to deal with is really, where does David's mind come from, and how does he get this confidence and this faith in, and where does this come from that he's able to stand up at 16 years old and face a giant? Not only that, all through his life up to kingship, he is a person of faith. He is a person that operates a certain way. And I believe there's a couple things that he gathers in his life that makes his mission possible instead of his mission impossible. So what I want to talk to you about today is what makes your mission possible. What makes your mission possible? What makes your purpose become a reality? What's going to give you the strength to overcome the challenges in your life so you can go and walk in destiny? What's going to make your purpose, your mission in life that God has for you, possible? But before I deal with what makes it possible, somebody say, we got to talk about what makes it impossible.
What makes it impossible?
We got to talk about what makes it impossible. There are nine things. These are not only things, but there's nine things that causes your mission to be impossible. I want to talk about nine things that cause your mission to be impossible. The first one is, everyone say, what's the mission?
What's the mission?
That's the first one. The first thing that prevents or will stop you from making your mission possible is the reality you don't even know what the mission is. You don't even know what you're called to do. You don't know what the purpose is for your life. You don't know why God saved you and let the other person die. You don't know why God's hand is still dealing with you instead of giving up on you. You don't know why you still have a tug to the Lord, even though you might be sinning and defying and disobeying. You don't even know what your purpose is. You're like some people with a pen or a pencil. They use that pen and pencil to make big beats, to pull a weird at last out their ear, to suck on it and everything else. They cannot use the pen or pencil for the purpose it was created, because they don't get the purpose. The pen is not designed for you to suck on and chew on. It's designed to write something to somebody. It's an instrument used to communicate things. But if you don't know what your purpose is, you can never make your mission possible. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So the one reason your mission is impossible right now is because you don't even know what your mission is. If somebody had to put a gun up to your head, some of you would get shot and die because you don't know why God has called you and what specifically has for your life. It's nothing wrong with it from the standpoint if you're seeking God for clarity. But some of us have been living for God for a long time, and if they had to put a gun up to our head, we have no clue on why he saved us and why he brought us out. Paul understood what his mission was. The Bible says God saved him, and God told him that I want to make you my evangelist, my apostle, my leader, my witness to the Gentiles. I'm going to bring you before mighty men that you might see, that you might share the gospel of who I am. Moses knew what his purpose was. God said, I've heard my people cry for 400 years. I'm going to use you to be my deliverer. You shall bring my people out of bondage, out of Egypt. Joseph knew what his purpose was. He said, God showed me a dream that I was sitting in a position and my mom and my daddy and my brothers and sisters bowed down to me. And Joseph begins to go through the whole life holding on to his purpose. Though he was sold like a slave, though he was put in jail, though he was lied onto, because he knew what his mission was, it kept him focused to make his mission possible. The challenge with some of us, we don't even know what our mission is. And it's impossible to walk in purpose if you don't know what it is. Thank you. Number two, another reason that causes your mission to be impossible is wrong priorities. Somebody say wrong priorities.
Wrong priorities.
Some of us got the wrong priorities. If you were to ask our heart of heart, it would be us first, my kids second, scandal third, and God fourth. If you were to ask our heart of hearts, so you don't think I'm talking about you, I know I've been hitting scandal all year long. I'll stop in 2016, all right? But then some of y'all is Dallas Cowboys first, Dallas Mavericks second, Texas Rangers third, and somewhere down the line is God. We got the wrong priorities. What we prioritize is all messed up. Our finances are about us. Our lives are about us. Our houses are about us. Our cars are about us. And because of that, our mission is impossible because our priorities are messed up. Somebody say, I got some things messed up.
I got some things messed up.
Got the wrong priorities. Your priorities ought to be God first. Whatever His will is for my life, whatever He desires for me, nevertheless, not my will be done. Not what I want to do, what I desire to do, where I want to go, but what He desires for me, His will be done. That ought to be first priority. God should be first, and He says, I'm a jealous God. I will not share you with anybody. I've got to be first. God wants second to be a distant second. So your family is distant when it comes to God. Your friends are distant when it comes to God. Your personal enjoyment are distant when it comes to God. God ought to be first in your priorities. Thank you, Jesus. The things of the Lord ought to be first in your priorities. And see, I'll never have happiness. I'll never have joy. I'll never have peace the way I'm supposed to as long as my priorities are messed up. Yeah, I'll get temporary enjoyment. You know what? It'll feel good going to that basketball game. But if I'm at the basketball game when I'm supposed to be spending time with God, that enjoyment is short-lived because I have to have my priorities in order. My prayer is non-negotiable. My word is non-negotiable. My relationship with Christ is non-negotiable. It's a priority in my life if I want my mission to be possible. Somebody give God some praise.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Hey, 9 things that cause your mission to be impossible. What's your mission? What wrong priority? Somebody say, minus the principles.
Minus the principles.
Minus the principles. Some of us are not principally driven in life. Let me point out a reason why. Some of us, when things get tough, we stop doing what we know to do in that's right in the sight of God. So instead of praying and seeking God when things get bad, we call somebody that can't help us anyways. We stop reading God's word. We stop giving. We stop coming to church. We stop playing them songs. I don't want to hear Jesus is on the main line no more. You take the CD out of your car and you stop listening to your church music and you start putting everything else but God. You get too sleepy to seek God. You get too tired to read your word. You get too lazy and too frustrated to spend time with God and make it to church. And because of that, you are minusing the principles. You're not principally driven. Principles mean they operate outside of emotion. Somebody say, this is not emotional. See, principles cause you to operate in who you are no matter what is going on in your life. But the moment you stop operating in who you're supposed to be, then I have to challenge, is that who you really are? Or are you a principle-less person? Are you really a person that when things get tough, you quit? Are you really a person when things get tough, you give up? Are you really a person that really ain't real about God, but you are trying to live for God because you want something for Him? You want, and somebody say, a genie in a bottle if you rub me the right way. Some of y'all just want God to be a genie, that you have 3 wishes a week, and whatever you wish, I command, is what you want God to do. So because of that, your relationship is messed up, and you're not driven by the principle. God says you got to love and respect and serve me, regardless of if I do another thing in your life. God says you got to obey me, be holy, for I am holy. Don't try to get holy, but God says you got to flee fornication. You got to flee backbiting. You got to flee adultery. You got to flee all these sinful things. You got to walk away from things that are not godly if you're going to serve Him. He said,
amen,
these things will not inherit the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
But it's impossible for me to walk in my mission. It's impossible for me to walk a life filled with purpose if I don't have principles that guide my life. If my emotion is the main decision maker in my life, I'm in trouble. How many of y'all know emotions lie to you?
Mm-hmm.
Emotions will deceive you. How many of y'all have been hot about something because you thought somebody did you wrong and felt out they actually were doing something good for you? Yeah, I'm not the only one that ever, am I the only one that ever happened to? Oh, okay. All right. How many of y'all was feeling bad about something and then found out that it actually was working for your good? How many of y'all were frustrated about things that happened on your job to find out that God had a plan for you? See, emotions will deceive you. Emotions will get you feeling some kind of way that'll lead you in the wrong direction. But you've got to be principally driven. But the challenge, I can't walk in purpose if I'm minusing the principles. The next one, someone say, no ownership.
No ownership.
This one deals with the reality of self-responsibility. I cannot walk in purpose and reach the mission the Lord has for me if I don't take ownership for the things that have happened in my life. I had a choice to say yes or no on many things. And I said yes to some things I should have said no to. I said no to some things I should have said yes to. I went some places I shouldn't have went. And I did some things that I shouldn't have done. And I didn't do some things that I should have done. And because of that, if I don't take ownership in my life, it will prevent me from moving forward. I have to be a responsible person. God holds us accountable for what we do in this body. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. God holds us accountable for what we do in this life. And I can't spend my life blaming somebody else. Somebody say that's immature.
That's immature.
Immature people blame others. Immature people make excuses. Immature people got 17 different reasons why this thing didn't happen this way. Immature people justify their actions. Immature people operate in a way that is totally contrary to moving forward in life. And because of that, your mission is impossible because you're immature. You don't want to take ownership. You don't want to take accountability. You don't want to take responsibility for what is happening in your life. You want to blame the devil. Some of y'all blame the devil on more things than he can count himself. It's the enemy. It's the enemy coming against me. I know the devil is coming against me. No, you shouldn't have spent $60 buying this and you would have had your electricity money. But you spent $60 and you're going to say, Lord's going to provide my 60 by faith. There ain't no faith in that. That's called being ignorant is what we would call it. And not being good stewardship and being selfish and not being mature. Thank you, Jesus. Take ownership. I can't walk in my mission. My mission is impossible if I don't take ownership. Thank you. Next one. Someone say procrastinate. Procrastinate. Everyone say procrastinate. You know, I had procrastinate on there at first. But then the Lord just dealt with me, procrastinate. And the reason he gave me procrastinate, because some of us have an inherent gene in us that need to be delivered of, that we procrastinate things by our own personality and who we are. It's in us to just waste time and not respond and not do things we need to do. We always wait to do something. We're always going to say we're going to do something. We got a trait in us that we need to be delivered from. It's amazing to me how many of us come on Sunday mornings and we get a word that we know God told us, and we know God told us to do something, but because of that trait, we procrastinate. And we end up not responding to God's word. And then we wonder why we keep struggling. We wonder why we keep going through. We wonder why things don't turn over as quick as they need to. We wonder why we're still dealing with the same test over and over again, because we're procrastinating. We're procrastinating over and over again. We're putting off what God has told us to do. If God said move, you can't keep thinking about moving. If God said go forward, you can't. If God says let it go, you've got to do what?
Let it go.
If God says give it up, you've got to what?
Give it up.
If God says move forward, you've got to what?
Move forward.
But because of your procrastinate, because of that gene inside of you that needs to be delivered, you won't move forward when God says move forward. You won't be delivered when God says you're delivered. You won't be healed though God healed you 5 years ago. You got a procrastinate in you that's making your mission impossible. Somebody give God some praise. Thank you, Jesus. Hey, thank you. Somebody say ability, no skill.
Ability, no skill.
You got the ability to accomplish things, but the problem is you're not dedicated enough, long enough to see things become perfected. How many of y'all got gifts and talents that things you do well, but because you don't spend time at getting great at them, they do you not effective? This is going to make sense here when I get back to David, but how many of y'all are skilled with fashion or skilled music or skilled making things or skilled organizing things, skilled with so many different things, and your job is making money off of your abilities, but if you sharpen those skills, somebody will pay you for those skills, but you'll never get paid for them. You'll only have work for a company instead of work for yourself because you got ability, but you won't apply and develop the skill with your ability. Therefore, your mission is impossible because some things is going to come because God wants to do it outside your 9-to-5. God wants to do something. Some of y'all, the reason you're struggling with your 9-to-5 right now is because you're spending 40 hours a week on somebody else's dream and won't spend 5 on your own dream. Thank you, Jesus.
So you got ability inside of you. You got everything that you need to go walk in purpose, to reach your mission, but you don't want to put the time, effort, and energy into developing the skill with your ability. I have the ability to play basketball, but if I don't develop my shot, I'll never be able to shoot with what? Skill. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. And it's preventing you from walking in your purpose. Somebody say bad listening.
Bad listening.
Bad listening all the way around. Some of us, one, we listen to the wrong people and the wrong things. And because of that, we got nothing but junk inside of us. And we won't listen to God's word. We want to skip over the stuff that makes us have to change. We want to go to the stuff that makes us feel good, that makes us jump up for joy, and makes us have fun. But some of us are bad listening because we are bad listeners. We don't really hear God. A true listener not only hears, but he responds to God's word. It has nothing to do with my emotion. But if God speaks something to me, and boom, I say, oh, man. That he's talking about me. He's talking to me. A good listener would respond to what they've heard. But we've got some bad listening habits that cause us to enjoy a word and hear the word, and it goes in one ear and out what?
Yeah.
The other. And then we listen to junk. The Bible says that in the last days, they will be caught up in all kind of false doctrines, have an itching ear to listen to all kind of stuff. We want to listen to all kind of astronomy people, Scientology people, and some of y'all still believe that I'm a Gemini, I'm an Aquarius. Some of y'all buy into that junk. That ain't biblical, but you think your mood swing is because I'm a Gemini. You know how we end on this time of the year.
Oh, Lord.
And all this philosophy junk. But the Bible says something totally opposite of that. But you listen more to negative stuff that don't move you forward in your purpose than you listen to witchcraft junk more than you listen to the word of God and wonder why you messed up, wonder why you can't walk in purpose, wonder why you can't walk in your mission.
Well.
Bad listening. You listening to yourself too much. Yourself telling you can't do it. Yourself telling you won't make it. Yourself telling you you're nobody. You never. There was a TV movie that me and my brother, we always made fun of because he makes fun of the baseball player. He says, you ain't even a has-been. You were never was. And some of y'all tell yourself, you ain't even a has-been. You were never was. You never was going to make it. You never was going to be somebody. You never was going to be victorious. You never was going to open up that business. You never was going to start that school. You never was. Whatever it is, you never was. And so because of that, your mind frame is messing up. Your bad listening is preventing you from walking in your mission.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. I'm almost done here. We'll get to the part you can shout on. Somebody say death over change. Y'all heard me preach this earlier this year, but they found up something crazy, something that blew my mind. Do you know most people would rather die than change? Most people would rather die than change. Well, prove it, preacher. Let me prove it. How many people you know get their legs cut off and are unhealthy because they won't eat right? The doctor tells them they gotta change their eating habit, but they refuse to change their eating habit because they'd rather die and enjoy their junk than change and live longer. Some of us would rather die than change. We'd rather do what we wanna do, when we wanna do it, where we wanna do it, how we wanna do it, instead of change according to God's word. And because of that, we're dying and we don't even realize it. We're losing everything that we wanted, the promises we desired, we're not having them because we would rather die. We'd rather just be me than change it and be who God has destined you to be. And because of that, that makes your mission impossible. When you have a not changing mentality that you're not going to change, this is just me, this is just who I am, this is just who I is, this is me, baby, this is me. You got that mentality. Did I hit the spot there? You got that mentality, you will die instead of change. And your mission, everything you hope for you and your family, everything you're desiring, everything you know God spoke to you and God showed you he wanted to do in your life, you'll never get there because you're not willing to change. You just got to be who you are. Well, go ahead and be who you are and miss what God has for you. Last reason why your mission is impossible. Somebody say, no, Lord. One powerful thing about David, the Bible says every time David went out, one, it said the Spirit of the Lord was with him from that day forward. So everything David did, God was with him. And then even when David ran into adversity and challenges, David would pray and say, God, shall I overtake them? Shall I succeed? Shall I be victorious? And the Bible says God will respond, I am with you and you shall succeed and you shall go forward. And the challenge with us, we're doing so much junk and we're trying to accomplish so many things, but we never stop to ask the question, is God with us in this? Some of our struggle is because God is not with us. Some of our challenges is because God is not in agreement with the direction we're going. He's not in agreement with the things we're doing. He's not in agreement with the way we think and the way we act and where we're going. He's not in agreement with it. And because he's not in agreement with it, we're on our own. Yet we're praying to God, make a way for me. We're praying to God, deliver me. We're praying to God, show me wisdom. We're praying to God, but we're praying for God to do things versus asking him, Lord, are you with me? Because for some things, God would say, no, I'm not with you. It's no different than when the Israelites with Joshua, they were a bad army. They was whooping everybody in the promised land. Everybody was scared in the promised land. But they went against one group and couldn't win. And they kept, hold on, we losing men left and right. We ain't never lost a battle. What's going on here? And the word came back. The reason they could not win the victory, the battle, because there was sin in the camp. God was not going to advance them with sin being in the camp. God was not going to favor them if sin was in the camp. God was not going to grant them victory and bless them and do good things for them if there was sin in the camp. And sometimes we can't move forward because there's some sin that we need to get rid of in our life. There's some things we need to be delivered out of. There's some hardness inside of us, some pride, some envy, some jealousy, some hurt, some pain, some things we need to come out of. And we can't go forward no matter how much we kick and scream because we got to deal with this stuff because it's making our mission impossible. No, Lord, thank you. That's a good place to pray for.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. No, Lord. No, Lord. 9 things that cause your mission to be impossible. What's the mission? I don't even know what my mission is. I got wrong priorities. I am not principally driven. I have no ownership. I don't take responsibility of the actions in my life. I procrastinate. I got a procrastinate in me. It's in my nature to waste and not respond and do what I know I need to do. I have ability, no skill. I'm not dedicated enough to see God move and use whatever he's blessed me with. I'm a bad listener. I'd rather die than change, and I ain't even got the Lord with me in the direction that I'm going. Thank you, Jesus. Well, that brings me to back to David. After I didn't yell and all that stuff, now I can give you some good stuff to go home with. I want to talk about now, going back to the text we started with, 3 things that made David's mission possible. 3 things. Those 20-something years he was on the run from King Saul, those 27 years that he was struggling, there were 3 things that you find out in David that made his mission possible. Everyone say his foundation. Everyone say his favor.
His
favor. Everyone say his fight.
His fight.
Say it again. Everyone say his foundation.
His foundation.
His favor.
His favor.
His fight.
His fight.
Let's start with his foundation. Psalms 23:4 says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me. What was David's foundation? David was a shepherd. He grew up as a boy, as a shepherd, and he had a staff. And he learned fundamentally while he was out there with the sheep. He learned how to care for people. He was going to need that as a king. He learned how to lead a sheep. He was going to need that as a king. He learned how to protect the sheep. We just read where it talked about he was able to destroy a lion and a bear. He learned how to fight. He learned how to operate. Even on his own, he learned how to deal with sheep. And the crazy thing about those sheep, they couldn't tell him what he needed by just talking. He had to observe them. He had to learn them. He had to know how to protect them from ditches and make sure they don't eat too much and hit them on the head when they're doing something crazy. He had to learn how to build a fundamental things that was going to impact his purpose. His foundation was everything to him. That staff represented his, Rick Warren said something powerful about Moses in a message that he gave one time. He said, Moses' staff, the Bible says that God says, what's in your hand, Moses? And what was in Moses' hand was a staff. And that staff represented three things to him. It represented his identity, his income, and his influence. Someone say identity.
Income. Influence.
In that staff of what was in his hand, it said who he was. It also spoke to what his resources would be, how he would be able to accomplish things. He can bring in income. He can be able to have resources because of what was in his hand. And then it talked about his influence, how he was able to influence others. It was the staff that Moses put in the water that parted the Red Sea. It was the staff that turned into a snake and ate Pharaoh's two snakes. It was the staff that God used mightily through Moses. It was what was in his hand. Somebody say, what's in your hand?
What's in your
foundation is everything. What kind of foundation do you have? You might not have a staff like Moses or David, but what foundational things do you have that's going to impact your purpose? What have you incorporated into your life? What have you learned from the jobs you've been working, from the experiences you have gained in life? How much of that have you gained and allow it to be foundational in you in a way that will prepare you or propel you into your purpose? David was able to do so many things because of his foundation. David was able to get 400 men. David was on the run. The Bible says he had 400 men that came looking for him because of his foundation. They saw leadership in David. They saw quality. They didn't have nowhere else to go. They didn't have nothing else. And they were willing to follow David, who was a renegade according to the king. He was rebellious according to the king. He was on the run. He was wanted according to the king. But what these 400 men would follow him, even though he was a wanted man, because of his foundation. And you're going to need a foundation in Christ to walk in your purpose. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. And his foundation developed his principles, his work ethic, even his understanding of the Lord. And one big thing about his foundation, it built his character. See, your character is being built right now. And the things that you're going through, it's building your character. God says, I know your beginning from the end. I already know what I have planned for you. Jeremiah 29:11, thoughts of good and not evil, but to bring you an expected end. In other words, God's got an end for you where you're victorious and not defeated. But the challenge is, you won't get to that purpose if you're not allowing the things you go through to build your character. Some of you are allowing what you're going through right now to destroy your character, to break down your character, for you to become something you're not supposed to be. But somebody say, I'm being built up.
I'm being built up.
Your foundation is being built. Number two, and what was his favor? His favor was found in his heart. Check this out. Listen to this text, 1 Samuel 16. And one of the young men answered, behold, I have seen a son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite, who is skillful in playing, a man of valor, a man of war, prudent in speech, and a man of good presence, and the Lord is with him. Check this out. His heart is what made him seeable. You got to ask yourself, what is that thing that makes you seeable? What is the thing that people call you out on? Is it your smile that makes people want to be around you? Is it your laugh that makes people want to be around you? Is it your word of encouragement? Is your ability to organize and accomplish things? What about you is people will ask for? Because that's where your favor comes from. That's where your favor on your job, even your enemies, even people that can't stand you on your job, they will call you based upon your heart, whatever your heart is in your life. And it says that David had a heart that he played skillfully, that allowed him, his heart allowed him to get into the presence of the king. He was able to go into the bedchamber of the king because of his heart, because of his skill, because of his ability. And you got to ask yourself, what ability or skill do I have in the life that people, in my life, that people will call me up for? When they need somebody to talk to the kids and motivate the kids, you know who they call? They call me. When they need somebody to work out and get solutions and work out problems and how to associate and how to deal with this, they call me. All my life, people have called me. As a matter of fact, every time I work here, they say, man, I need a word. I need you to just say something to me, man. Quote me a scripture or just tell me some thought that you have. Just give me something, because they understood that my gift was what making room for me. All my life, I've been one that's motivated people, that's inspired people, that's been able to speak words to people, give them words of wisdom, encourage others. That's a part of what makes room for me, what grants me my favor. What grants you your favor in your life? That's key to making your mission possible. What opens up doors for you? And are you spending time developing that thing that opened doors for you? Maybe it's the fact that you can bake cookies like nobody else. Bake your cookies. You don't know. The president of your company might want some cookies one day. But if you ain't baking your cookies and nobody knows you're baking cookies, you'll never get in front of the president. And see, the baking of cookies is getting in front of the president so you can ask the president, hey, I need a raise, or I need you to do this for me. But some of y'all are missing the favor of God in your life because you're not spending time on the things that God has made you good and great in. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He was so good. And 22, it says, Saul tells Jesse, let him remain with me, for he has found favor in my sight.
Amen.
What do they call you for? Check this out. Do they call you when they need to be motivated, or do they call you when they want to talk about some junk? Do they call you when they need a problem solved, or do they call you because they want you to help start some problems? Do they call you when they need guidance, or they just need you to justify their actions? Thank you, Jesus. What is brings you favor? Is your favor your praise? Is your favor your worship? What makes your mission possible is your favor. Thank you, Jesus. Last one, the third thing. Somebody say it was his fight.
It was his fight.
It's his fight. So we go all the way back to where we get started from, Goliath. Now this kid, 16 years old, goes against a 10-foot man with a staff in one hand and a slingshot in the other hand. No sword, no knife, no dagger, no gun. A staff and a slingshot. And he's extremely confident with his staff and his slingshot. He understood his slingshot was his fight. It represented his fight. And how many of y'all got a slingshot? You got something that represents your fight. Part of my fight, and when things get tough in my life, part of my fight is that I operate in my confidence, which some people say is borderline arrogant, but I'm very confident in myself. I'm very confident in the ability that God has placed inside of me. So when things get tough in my life, I resort to my confidence. I resort to my focus. I know how to get focused when things get tough. I know how to get laser focused on things. That's my slingshot, the ability to get focused in the midst of hell that I'm going through, in the midst of the ups and downs, to get focused. What is your slingshot? Maybe your slingshot is your praise. When things, somebody said a song, my praise is my weapon. How many of y'all heard that song? My praise, maybe your praise is your slingshot and it's your fight. But the problem is some of you have stopped your praise because of what you're going through. Y'all didn't see the Goliath in your life and you stopped using your weapon. Maybe it's your laugh that makes you is your slingshot. Maybe it's your speaking positivity is your slingshot. Maybe some of y'all trash talking is your slingshot. You need to talk crazy to the devil because that's what gets you going. That's what makes you move forward. Whatever it is, what is your slingshot? What is your fight that will help you go forward? For David, it was his slingshot. He was confident with the ability to use a tool that you had to have high skill to be able. And the Bible says it only took one stone to knock Goliath out. David was that good and that cold with his fight. He was that cold with his slingshot. He only needed one smooth stone. He had five, but he only needed one to knock out the giant. Y'all ain't got the revelation on that. See, you don't need a whole bunch of stuff to get victory. You just got to be good at the one thing God's giving you to be good at. If it's prayer, you need to be a prayer warrior, if that's what God is giving you. If it's somebody, if it's having faith, you got to rely on your faith. If it's being able to just speak things into your life, you better speak those things. If it's writing things out to release yourself to stay victorious, you better write like nobody else. You just need one good thing that'll help you with your fight, and it'll slay the enemies in your life. But the problem is that you're not working on that one thing. You're only getting distracted by the enemy, and you forgot what was your fight. You forgot what was in your head that moves you forward, that brings you victory. Don't forget your fight. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Maybe some of y'all fight is being angry. The Bible says be angry and sin not, okay? So maybe some of y'all do best when you just mad about something and it just moves you and you say that ain't gonna happen. Maybe that you gotta get emotional on something to move. Whatever it is, under God's wisdom, you gotta learn what your fight is, what gets you moving, what helps you overcome. Some of y'all need to talk to yourself. Some of y'all probably are people that talk to yourself. No, it ain't gonna happen to me. No, you didn't. What did you think? Maybe you need to talk to yourself, and because of the attack of the enemy, you stop talking to yourself. But that was your slingshot. That was your way of winning the battle. That was your way of overcoming. That was your way. Maybe some of y'all just need some sleep. Maybe the devil got you up all night and your slingshot was just to go to sleep when hell break loose. And you need to sleep some more so you can be ready for the fight. There were three things that David had that made his mission possible. His foundation, his favor, his fight. His foundation started with the staff. The staff represented his shepherd, being a shepherd and learning all the fundamental things he was going to need as a leader. Some of y'all in jobs, they've been in jobs because God is trying to teach you something through that, that he's going to help you for your purpose. Some of y'all fighting that and you ain't learning what God has for you. Take the skills and then God elevates you and moves you on. Sometimes we're where we are longer than what we're supposed to be because we haven't learned what God is trying to teach us. And God is patient and long-suffering, so he'll let you go through your hell for a long time until you get what you're supposed to get, and then he elevates you and moves you on. Thank you, Jesus. His favor. David was a complete heart. 14 of his 70 psalms is what kept him in that 20 years when his life was threatened. He wrote songs that comfort him. Psalms 34, that's where it comes from. I will bless the Lord at all times. He literally was getting ready to have his life taken when he wrote that song. But he wrote songs that the Lord is my buckler, he is my shield, who shall I fear? He wrote that when he was struggling and he was getting a cave. I got a message. What do you do when you're stuck in a cave with your enemy? He wrote that when Saul and his army was coming to kill him. And they happened to take rest in the cave that him and his men were hiding in. What does he do when he's stuck in the cave with his enemy? But he wrote a song of how God was his buckler, his shield. So his harp was his way of expressing and moving on and getting to where God has for him. Then his slingshot. He developed skill with his slingshot. He was a bad man with his slingshot. That was how he fought. He didn't fight using a sword. He didn't fight using anything else. His slingshot was his weapon for his fight in the time of adversity. What is your slingshot? Is it your laugh, your praise, your smile, your writing ability, your ability to just make others feel better? What is your slingshot that's going to propel you into your purpose? These are the things that make your mission possible. Let us stand.